Hey, this is Leon Poe, man. You listen to the Causeway Street Podcast.
What's up, y'all? This is Kenny Anderson. Y'all listen to the Causeway Street Podcast.
For all you new listeners out there, I'm your host, Josue Pavone. I'm joined, as usual, by my two co-hosts.
I'm Sean Dutra. What's up?
Sound like talk
John
about
walks
yourself.
On the beat.
There you go. Joel Pavone. What up?
I'm a Pisces. The most romantic.
He leads off with that.
The most romantic sign in all of the zodiac.
Oh.
You couldn't tell by my voice already.
Oh.
Sexy.
But I'm the producer of this ensemble that we call Causeway Street. In case you missed it.
Hey, Bill Walton here, Celtics 1986. You're listening to the Causeway Street Podcast. Yeah. Come here for nothing but the truth. This is where dreams come true. Thank you, Boston, for my life.
Where are we going?
You guys are such homers.
It's your boy Terry Rozier. You're listening to the Causeway Street Podcast. Now listen to my boys Joe Sway, Joel, and Sean.
Yeah, all right. Hey, everybody. Welcome into the Causeway Street Podcast. I am not Joe Sway Pavone. I am Sean Dutra. Joe Sway Pavone is sick. We have the Causeway Street curse alive and well. I think it's been like five straight episodes. Actually, last time we had a full staff.
Yeah.
Last time was the first time in a long time we had a full staff.
I think this curse now is like making its second round.
Yeah.
Around the all of us.
Yeah. I think I've gotten it twice.
Yeah, so.
So you're fucked.
Yeah, I'm fucked.
But welcome in. We're going to have a great show anyways. Minus Sway. Who needs Sway on a day like today, right, Joel?
But get well, bro.
Yeah. Yeah.
No love lost.
Yep. That's very true. We'll hold it down. But we have a ton to talk about today. It is nearing the trade deadline. The Celtics have just come off a four-game losing streak by beating the Los Angeles Clippers.
A season high, yep. Losing streak.
Season high, four games. I'll take a four-game losing streak than be Cleveland right now. But still, season high. So we're going to talk about that, what we learned from that losing streak, how the Celtics looked, I think, was the biggest problem in that losing streak. So we'll talk about that, especially the teams they lost to, too. Gross. Ugh, nasty team.
Disgusting.
Yeah. We'll get into that. Also, you know, the trade deadline is sneaking up upon us this year. Normally, we wait for it a little bit later on, but since the season started earlier, February 8th, that's right around the freaking corner, man.
Everything gets pushed up, minus the All-Star game. All-Star game is like in March this year.
Yeah, you know, they're like,
what's up with that?
They might as well put it after the season. Seriously. They should.
Do it like, you know, the Pro Bowl.
Yeah. I think that would be better ratings than people half-assed it in February.
Yeah.
But, so we get the trade deadline. Do the Celtics need to make a move? That is a simple question, yes or no. We'll see what Joel says. We're also bringing our good old friend, Zach Pelequin, to join the broadcast when we get into who the Celtics should be looking at for trades. But let's talk about the Celtics' recent play. So, you know, like I said, four-game losing streak to the likes of the Pelicans, 76ers, the Lakers. These teams are not good, Joel.
No.
So,
well, the Pelicans, I mean,
they're not good.
I mean, but they're in the middle of the Western playoff run, playoff picture, and I think that's the only team that kind of figured out the Celtics in terms of like not letting them get in the paint.
Sure. I mean, that was probably one of the closest games on that. Minus the Lakers game as well. Those two games are pretty close. But I think what we want to talk about is what happened to the Celtics on this stretch. They come off that crazy first half of the year.
Yeah.
Where they've been playing back-to-back every other night. They seemed like they had a game. They seemed like they had a back-to-back coming up every week. They go out. They take a nice long London Euro holiday.
Hello.
And then they come back and just lay a couple stinkers out there. So,
especially at home, which is bad.
Yeah, at home against teams that you should win. The Celtics have a really tough schedule coming up.
Yeah.
So these were sort of gimme wins I think they really needed and may come back to bite them. But let's toss it to you. What's your biggest takeaway from that four-game losing streak? And do you think that the Clippers win is something they can build off of? Or do you think it could be we're in that January time of the year where Just they're not getting up for the games.
Well, a couple things. One, still a lot of playing catch up, which I think it's starting to catch up to them now.
Nah. I don't know.
I mean, Steven said it after the Sixers game where...
You can't make a habit of it.
Exactly. That's one thing I took away. Still a lot of that. Stevens has been on record saying that in that 16-game win streak, they probably should have lost like 11 of those games.
11?
Yes, that's what he says. You know, 11 of those games.
Okay. So what does he think they were like a lottery team?
Well, remember how he was like smiling ear to ear when they lost to the Bulls, right? When they got shitted on by the Bulls. Remember that?
Yeah.
He's like, yeah, this is He's what like, I've been telling you guys. Mm-hmm. You guys are not that good.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So that's, I guess, in some ways, that's, slice of that humble pie. Kyrie even talked about like this good for the team to go through this adversity that they're going through, I guess, if whatever you want to call it. The second thing that I noticed during that skid was that they're still depending too much on Kyrie Irving.
Yeah, sure.
All right, the game that Kyrie didn't play against the Sixers, they only managed to score 80 points, season low. And then the following game, he comes.
That game was ugly. That game was.
Yeah,
ugly.
The following game, he comes back and puts up 40 points
and a loss.
Yeah. So it's like.
So yeah. So
you know, you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't. When it comes to like Kyrie, right? Like he's out. So, you know, people didn't step up. And then when he's in there, they're like, all right, you know, Kyrie's back. So it should be more of the same. But
I think it all comes down to, yeah, Kyrie Irving, he needs to be on for the Celtics to be able to win on a consistent level. Yeah. But I think this shouldn't be coming as a shock to like Celtics fans and, you know, people who follow this team, because your third and fourth scores on this team are 19 and 21 years old. They're going to have ups and downs.
Oh, you're right.
So like this is part of what we have to deal with. So like obviously you're going to take the good with Tatum and Brown and the way they're playing when they're on and they're young and developing. But still, this is a team that has championship aspirations this year. So yes, we need to expect that. But
is it like kind of fool's gold though with those two?
No, it's not fool's gold. I don't think it's fool's gold. I think you see what you can get out of them. I think there's going to be more nights that they're good than they are bad, right?
Okay.
So that's a good thing for a 19 and 21 year old. But
it is. But then when they are bad though, it's like
you gotta figure out how to get it. Well, you gotta figure out how to work around that.
Right.
That's one of the things that I came into the season and I said. It's going to be very tough to rely on Jaylen Brown and Jason Tatum to be consistent scoring. Like, what you get from them is great, but when you rely on them the way the Celtics have once they lost Gordon Hayward, you're going to go through streaks like this. It's going to happen. I thought it was a good thing to see Tatum have a good game against the Clippers and Brown sort of start to show some signs of life of, you know, going back to that. You know, I don't think Jaylen Brown's a scorer per se, but affecting the game defensively. Getting to the bucket.
That's another thing I want to bring up.
What, Jaylen Brown can't make any layups?
No.
Can't hit an alley-oop when he needs to?
No.
You know how pissed off I was about that?
I'm talking about defense.
Oh, okay.
The Celtics against the Clippers went back to defense.
Yeah.
Forcing turnovers, limiting outside three-pointers, uh-huh. You know, outside shots in general. And that was part of their makeup. The first half of the season. So, like you said, are they able to build on that? You know,
we'll
hopefully.
See. And hey, they got a huge test coming up against the Warriors.
There's no one better to have a test against than the champions.
The Warriors. So that's coming up. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But let's bring in Zach Pelequin, our guest host. I don't even know how we introduce him now. Is he just guy on the street, Zach Pelequin?
For today, he's the third guy in.
Third guy in.
Usually he's our capologist.
Capologist. We've used that term.
Causeway Street blog writer.
Okay.
You know, he's a jack of all trades.
A jack off. Oh, okay. There he is. Zach, what's up, man?
What's going on, boy?
What's happening? Thank you for joining us.
Happy New Year, by the way.
Yes, Happy New Year. Merry Christmas.
All that. I know. It's been a little while.
Yeah.
Hope you enjoy Kwanzaa.
Fantastic holiday. I enjoyed it quite a bit.
My favorites. Nice.
All right, so, you know.
Second favorite civil engineer.
You've been on the line for a little bit listening to our discussion here on the state of the Celtics. What do you think, you know, we're a little bit past the halfway point. They're struggling a little bit, even though they snapped their four-game losing streak to the Clippers. What do you see going forward? What did you see during the skid, or at least the last five games, that you're concerned about or you're happy about? What's your take?
I think as of right now, it's kind of one of those points in the season where the younger guys are starting to see how just how long the NBA season is. Sorry, I got a dog freaking out in the background. How long and how treacherous the NBA season can be. I mean, you're talking about two guys who, like you said, young players, you know, 21 years old for Jaylen Brown and 19 for Jason Tatum. So you're talking about a combined, year and a half of NBA experience. And, I mean, it wears on you, especially for the amount of pressure that's on these two players since Gordon Hayward went down. Both these guys are starting pretty much every night, playing 25, 30 minutes a night, which was not the expectation for Jason Tatum coming out. And I think even Jaylen Brown, they were probably thinking closer to 25 minutes a night. So you get these guys playing a ton of minutes, and eventually you are physically going to wear down. So I think the All-Star break is something that they're really looking forward to, get a few days to hopefully rest up a little bit and get ready for their second half. And additionally, they also were missing Kyrie Irving for a few of those games as well, or at least one of them, to my recollection. And not having your number one man out there, that's going to be an issue, no doubt.
Yeah.
They do lean on Kyrie quite a bit to score the basketball.
Yeah, so, I mean, where do you, and one thing we didn't get into is this whole team meeting that happened in LA, right?
That's right.
They locked the door and they talk like men.
Well, yeah.
they broke like bread.
I mean, a lot of these team meetings going around the league, and it's a lot of these like conversations that leak. But
I will this, probably say Celtics, this: the Celtics team meeting was probably
it was tight-lipped.
A lot different than a LeBron James led team meeting in Cleveland.
In Cleveland, or
I can guarantee that. And that's why I'm sure that when Kyrie was asked about
San Antonio
shut it down real quick. He's like, no, nothing like that. So who knows what the hell that has to do with anything? But I think it does show.
It was after the Laker loss, so
yeah, they're serious about it. They don't want to lose to the Lakers.
I mean, I think they showed or kind of reverted back to the team that we saw for the most part of the first half of the season, and like I said, it boils down to defense.
So. Let's cut right to the chase then. Celtics are still the number one team in the Eastern Conference. They're showing maybe a couple signs of slowing down, but the trade deadline is right around the corner.
They have a three-game lead on the Raptors right now.
Right. Only a three-game lead. I mean,
they have the same amount in the loss column.
Yeah. But let's be honest. I mean, a three-game lead is... Not much.
Yeah.
I mean, you're looking at Cleveland sliding and the rest of the Eastern Conference falling off the face of the planet.
That's why it was annoying that they were losing these games because they're trying to build on this lead as the first seed. So.
Right. But what do we want to see the Celtics do with the trade deadline? I think that's the main question. I mean, we can get all riled up about a four-game losing streak in January. I tend to sort of stay away from that. That's why I really have nothing to say on this topic. So let's move on to some fun stuff to talk about. Who are the Celtics? Who are they going to need to trade? They need to add a piece, in my opinion. I think if they can take advantage of the Eastern Conference being weak this year and knowing that this is a year, I mean, I tend to think LeBron is leaving, but if LeBron doesn't leave, the Cavs will still be really good next year. So since they're in turmoil, this is the year you need to capitalize. So I'm not saying a big, huge move. I don't know what you guys think, but I know the Celtics need to add a piece, if not two, during this trade deadline.
What do you think, Zach?
Yeah, I mean, you kind of get a free hack at it because you have that injury exception because of Gordon Hayward, right? You're still talking about $8.4 million off the cap, no questions asked, that you can go make a deal for or go get someone off of the free agent block. So, I mean, since that money's there, I can't imagine Danny Ainge is just going to look at that and say, you know what, screw it, we don't need anyone, we'll just go forward. We don't really know if Hayward's going to be back, whether it's playoffs or otherwise. And, you know, there's they keep denying that he's going to come back. So you got to have a little bit more depth. And now we're seeing some of these younger players wear down because of the minutes and struggling a little bit. So you kind of have to, you know, go out and get something. It doesn't have to be a superstar like you said, John. It doesn't have to be, I'm not talking about Anthony Davis. I don't expect that to happen at the trade deadline. But you've got $8.4 million sitting there to go get yourself a nice veteran player to put into that second unit, whether it's a score, whether it's a big, to be able to give yourself a little bit more in that rotation. There's three names that come to mind for me. I think is going to be the toughest to get your hands on, but I think would be the most helpful, and that's Lou Williams.
I've been preaching Lou Williams.
Before he was on like a tear of 30 points a game.
Don't matter. The Clippers ain't going anywhere.
The Clippers are at six right now in the West, and they weren't even in the playoff picture a month ago.
All
right,
if they think Lou Williams is going to take him to the promised land,
well, they talk about extending him. I don't know. That's a tough one.
Build your team around Lou Williams. That's okay. A great idea.
Well, my point is that the asking price is going to be too high, in my opinion, now. Mm. Instead of you were talking about a second rounder.
No, late and, first rounder.
Okay. All right.
Give late, me Celtics
late,
pick.
Late first rounder. And then what else?
And I don't know.
Well, whatever you, I don't remember exactly what you said, but whatever you had as a deal, potential deal,
I mean,
it would be too low for freaking the Clippers at this point.
So you, I don't know how valuable is Lou Williams for the Celtics? I mean, do you give up on a Marcus Smart or a Terry Rozier? Zach, calm down about Marcus Smart. Okay, I know what you're gonna say, but Marcus Smart, but do you want to mess up chemistry and bring in a guy that's just a scorer? I think if you can get Lou Williams cheap, then fine.
Well,
fine.
Okay, Zach, how about this? Do you know? Well, the length of his contract, does he have another season? After
no, this is his last year.
He's got 1 year on $7 million. He is available for trade, so yes. You can get him just on the exception.
So if they are going to give up on him,
well, the exception can't be combined with something else. It has to be straight up. Yeah,
sure. Sure, but
I don't know if the Clippers, will go for
it. I don't even know if I want to use the exception though. I want Gordon Hayward to come back.
So, but then you got to throw salary
fine
the other way.
Yes, I would rather trade a couple pieces, a couple younger players that maybe, I mean, if you got to include a guy like Daniel Tice in a trade like that, I mean,
shoring up the front court, even though it's already kind of short as is.
I don't know. I mean, you put Baines in there. I mean, Baines, he hasn't been getting a ton of run lately. I mean, I don't know. I think the two untouchable pieces, in my opinion, other than the ones you know, would be
overall or for Lou Williams?
For Lou Williams, okay. Or a player of the caliber of Lou Williams, I don't think I'm giving up on Terry Rozier and Marcus Smart. Unless Danny Ainge knows that he's not going to re-sign Marcus Smart at the end of this year, I still hesitate to pull that trigger because Marcus Smart means so much to the chemistry of this team.
I think any move that the Celtics are potentially make at the trade deadline, it's gonna be a rental. I don't think it's gonna be a long term thing.
Yeah, so I think you probably if you're looking at Lou Williams and trust me, I think he fixes a lot of problems. A lot of problems because
mainly
scoring the basketball. That's all we want. Right. Scoring the basketball. Right. Like I just don't know. I think it's a huge risk to trade Marcus Smart.
Well, I mean,
it's huge. You're not trading Terry Rozier because I think you like what you see in him.
Yeah, but I think Lou Williams is a borderline all-star this year. It's the asking prices will be too high.
You could get him for Marcus Smart.
What do you think, Zach? You mentioned Lou Williams. Who would you put in a deal if you couldn't just use the player exemption or the disabled player exemption?
Well, I think you got to think about, and I think Sean's on the opposite with Marcus Smart. I mean, you got to think about his re-signability this summer. I mean, he's going to be 12 to 15 million a year yet, I think. Even being a restricted free agent, he's got to get an offer sheet somewhere else. Or at least I think he is, because he's getting a lot of good reviews, being such a good defender, having a great year defensively, and the fact that he is a locker room guy. He's probably, for my betting purposes, I think he's probably more or less the leader of the Celtics team right now. Yeah, you could say it's Kyrie, but Marcus Smart kind of set the tone. And I'm a Marcus Smart hater.
You are. I'm very surprised you're even saying this right now.
I don't like this, Zach. Well, man. I don't like. Is this a new you? Is this a new
coming around?
Is this a 2008 version around of you? 2018? I don't like it.
I don't like him. I can play better offensively than he can. I've got a better Jay than he does.
All right, then. Why are the Celtics not looking at you then to bring you in?
Because I can't defend.
Can't play D.
I just said it. Yeah.
Slow, white, all those things, all the above.
Oh damn! All right, so then who else on your list? You were mentioning other other potential candidates.
Yeah, so other guys a little bit further down the food chain. There's two bigs that I really like, and one of them's Ersan Ilyasova. I mean, you talk about a guy who can play on the perimeter, about 6'9", 6'10", pulls down. I think he's doing 6 boards a game, about 10 or 11 points a game. Rotational big, he would fit into what Brad Stevens looks for in his bigs. Someone who can shoot from the outside, keep things stretched out. Not a great defender, not a great rebounder, but, I mean, just call it what it is. It's another rotational, you know, 4-5 guy that you can stick underneath the basket.
Nah, gross. I think that's disgusting, Zach. Wait, are you gonna, and these are for the trade exception? That's what, the injury exception?
Yeah, he would just be a pure exception in the second round or just to get.
Nope, I'd much rather keep my fingers crossed for Gordon Hayward than have a guy that's literally not going to impact your team. Like, Ilyasova is not, I mean, if you could get him with still hoping for nothing and hoping Hayward could come back, fine. But you got to also think, like, Ilyasova, he's just an NBA body, right? Like, and you basically have admitted that, too. So I would keep my fingers crossed for Hayward rather than eliminate that chance but for Ersan Ilyasova. That's disgusting.
But you forget. What were your feelings on Aaron Baines when the Celtics signed him?
It was gross.
Okay. So, you know, what do you think of him now?
I mean, he's a solid rotational player.
Okay. So I think what Zach is saying that in this system, Brad Stevens would make this dude look more than just a body. He would be someone who contributes on a nightly basis instead of depending on who am I thinking of right now?
That's what I'm saying. Like,
Yabusele or
they don't depend on him.
Or Nader. Oh, I mean,
They come in from time to time, yeah. Depending on.
I don't want
to
see Nader at all on the floor. That's what I'm coming. Okay. That's what it boils down to.
But I think you make a trade and you use that exception if you think the move could potentially put you.
And again, this is just short term. This is like the season.
Put you in a better position to win. All right. Ilyasova doesn't, right, or whatever he fell the fuck you say his name.
Yeah, that was right actually. Who's your third guy?
Last one is a Boston native, Boston boy, and knows Noel. And he's not being used in Dallas. He's one of those guys that,
that I would do.
Stories out there that he might be a buyout candidate.
Really? Because I've been reading like all season long that Dallas is trying to pull off what Minnesota did with Joe Smith like 10, 15 years ago and like kind of stash him to like offer him the most that they can offer him because they're like other teams won't give him a big offer because he hasn't been playing this year. So he signed a 1-year restricted free agent deal last summer. Mm-hmm. And Dallas is like, all right, you know, we'll get you paid more, but we can't really use you and display you because other teams are gonna be like, well, you only signed a 1-year deal. You know, what's going on there in Dallas? And a lot of teams apparently do this, but it's like hush hush. So I don't know if you guys have heard anything about that. I mean, if he is available, that's a great
conspiracy theory. You wanna drop the beat?
It's not my conspiracy theory. It's a theory that I've been reading about.
I like it.
Yeah. So
I like it. It's dirty.
Yeah, it is. I mean, Minnesota got caught with it with Joe Smith like 20 years ago.
Well, I mean.
And it cost them dearly.
Yeah. Yeah. Who knows, man? I mean, yeah. If he's available in the trade and they're going to give up on him, I would love to see it.
I've been wanting him on the Celtics for a few years now.
Yeah, if you could get him for nothing. Now, we were talking about giving up the damn Brooklyn pick for him.
Well, I mean, if Dallas is like, you know what, forget it. You know, maybe we can get something for him. Then I think that's probably the best option if he is available in terms of like these three players that Zach just mentioned. I like Noel.
Yeah, I still don't want to give up that pick though. The exception. I would give up a player. I would much rather give up a player. I mean,
why don't you want to use this exception? I don't get it.
Yeah, it's only.
I want him to come
rental.
Back.
That's all it is. It's a rental.
He can still come back.
Yeah, even if they use it, he can still come back.
What?
Yeah, that's the beauty of it.
It's not a one or the other situation. You can have both.
If he's able to, if Gordon Hayward was able to come back, and you use that exception on a player like Noel,
the injury exception,
then he's able to play still, and you have both.
Salary cap's a fucked up place.
Well,
doesn't even make
the player can only have 1 year on their deal, and they have to be under 8.4 for the full season.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, fine. Yeah, do it. Let's do it. Bring in Lou. Bring in Noel. I don't care who. Bring in the Pacers. Look at me, an uninformed asshole over here. I'm thinking we can't bring Gordon Hayward back if we use that.
No, you can. That's the beauty of it. It's like potentially you have like this credit that you can use. And
why, though? How'd they get the credit?
It's because of the injury that happened. It's more.
Yeah,
it's
they
more
had to apply
like,
to it to the NBA. Yeah,
could they get busted for like lying about how severe that injury was? Then
no, because the NBA.
All saw his foot facing the opposite direction. There was no.
But he's. but no, come on, no, man. It wasn't as bad because he's now shooting on 2 feet. Everyone that happened, we were like, he is done. He's never going to play basketball again. He is sure. never coming back to the NBA. Will he ever be the same? He's already taken 3-pointers on the court, and that was what?
Yeah.
4 months ago?
He's going to be like he was doing it. He was doing it against before the Celtics took on the Clippers.
That's what I'm saying. That's why it's so mind-blowing to me that we actually can use the exception and have Hayward come back.
He's probably going to become like the NBA's like best setup shooter without having to like barely
he's just gonna
get
be,
off the ground.
Or he'll just sit in a chair.
And just shoot.
Just wheel him around. Oh, well, you guys just blew my mind.
Yeah,
dude.
No, the Celtics applied for this and the NBA granted it. They were like, yeah, man. Like, we all saw, everybody saw, like Zach said,
Danny
the way
Ainge
his foot was
wins
facing.
Again, huh?
So,
all right.
I mean, it's a no brainer that if you can use it on someone that's going to contribute this season, then fucking why not?
Okay, it's a no brainer. You're right. Yeah. I'm an idiot.
So, I like those. I like that list, but I do like the last person you mentioned.
Nah, I go Lou Williams and over anybody.
I think I think out of everyone on that list, he's the hardest person you're gonna get because
yeah, there'll be a market for him. But I mean, Celtics also have a lot of draft picks though too, right?
Yeah.
So if they do want him, they can get him.
And there's also the Celtics are also going to be players in the free agent market when it comes to players that get waived or bought out after the trade deadline.
Mm. All right. So yeah, I mean, it will be interesting to see who does get bought out. I mean, there's a lot of names floating around out there. I know. So maybe before we get into the buyout market, I read an article. 6 trade pieces that the Celtics possibly should go after. I'm just going to say them, and you say if you have any interest knowing what you'll have to give up for them.
Okay.
DeAndre Jordan.
Oh, that's a lot you're going to have to give up for.
Zach? So, are you interested?
I'm not interested.
No, I passed on that one.
All right, Marc Gasol.
Also, like I'm interested, but how?
Yeah, it depends on the price.
That's expensive.
Mm. Okay,
he's expensive.
Let's
at 32 years old, he's still expensive.
Let's say somehow you could swing a deal where it will be draft picks and you don't have to touch Tatum and Brown.
As long as it's not the Lakers / Nick or Kings pick.
Really?
If the Pacers have that, I'd go after it. Yeah, I wouldn't trade that for him. No.
Really?
Think about it. You could potentially have a number 2 pick this year and have what's his name, Marvin Bagley sitting in Boston next year.
True. I see. I'm not too. As much as I mean, whatever Danny Ainge will end up doing with the pick, I'm sure will work out because I can't hate on his.
makes me look like an idiot.
Every year it makes me look like an idiot. So I don't even care. But I just have a feeling this year, which I'll be wrong about again, and Danny Ainge will win. But I just have a feeling the Lakers won't fall between the 2 and the 5 pick. I don't think that like if LeBron wants to go there, like the NBA controls the lottery, as we all know. And even if they do fall between that 2 and 5, they're going to be outside. They're going to get the number 1 pick or they'll, you know, get the 6th pick or whatever it is. I got a weird feeling about this. It's too small of a window. So I'm going to potentially give up on that pick.
All right.
If you can get, I don't think I would do it for DeAndre Jordan. I probably would do it for Marc Gasol. He's got 2 years left on his deal. I would.
He's not, 32 years old too, though.
He is. He's also Spanish.
Is he going to be? This is true.
He's European.
He's one of those where he's coming to the end of his prime. Well, he has a group of players around him. If he's in Boston, that are just starting their prime. That's kind of like the KG deal you did. You know, what, 10, 11 years? Oh my God.
Yeah, but you know,
10 or 11 years ago.
You know what though? Goodness. Look at. I know. Jesus. Thanks, Zach.
We're getting old. Yeah, oh God.
What am I doing here?
Those were the days.
But hey, I will say this: I think you can get Marc Gasol at a pretty good deal. I don't think you have to give up Brown. I don't think you have to give up Tatum. And I also look at the way Pau Gasol has sort of had his brother, his blood, right, has had a late career renaissance where People said he was done, right?
In Chicago, he was an all-star in Chicago.
All-star in Chicago.
Still pretty productive in San Antonio,
But he's like 40 years old now, right? And now he's finally starting to slow down.
No, that's Manu.
Oh, sorry. He's one of the decrepit Spurs that are now trying to break down. But I think Marc Gasol has maybe 2 years left in him that you can get two really good years out of him. And you put him in the Eastern Conference. Mm. You put him on a team that has championship aspirations. I think Marc Gasol could really be a steal, especially because he's a perennial all-star. He's on a team that has literally no help this year.
Well, he's
no help.
He's already said, like, I don't want to waste my prime years.
Like, he loved
not,
Memphis.
Not competing, for a title. Yeah.
When you trade Z-Bo, when you trade...
Vince Carter?
Is that who I'm thinking
of?
Yeah,
that's what you're thinking of.
No. Oh, jeez. Team sucks.
Well, Conley hasn't been healthy. That's healthy, what I mean, obviously. Yeah. Chandler Parsons, he'll never be healthy.
No, he get. I think Marc Gasol,
their cap is strapped for a while for them to try to bring anybody in.
If you want to add Marc Gasol to this team and you could do it financially, I mean, maybe you got to give up a guy like Baines. Maybe it's fine. Fine.
Why is Baines in every single
contract? He's a contract single, number. He's a high contract. He's a high contract. Yeah. And Marcus Morris, I would begrudgingly, if you need to include his contract in the deal. Oof. I don't know. Marc Gasol's an all-star.
I understand. But you weaken the bench.
Sure.
If you were to do that.
Sure. But you also get a...
Oh, yeah. That's right. You could bring in,
You could bring in Lou Williams and Marc Gasol.
And Gordon Hayward's coming back, too.
And
right?
So Gordon Hayward.
There you go.
Best team ever.
There you go.
There we go.
All right, so who's the next on this list?
So the rest on the list, I mean, I'll quickly go over it. Anthony Davis is on the list, which I think is stupid. I don't even know why we still talk about that. We're going to wake up one day, and maybe it'll happen. But I just don't see it happening anytime soon.
No, I think with the Pelicans, they're all in on... trying to make the playoffs, obviously.
Okay, then that takes the other guy off the list, who was DeMarcus Cousins.
DeMarcus Cousins, yeah.
Which I would give my left nut.
Because the GM and their coach, their jobs are on the line if they don't make the playoffs or make some significant noise in the West.
And if the Celtics wanted DeMarcus Cousins, they would already have DeMarcus Cousins.
Yep.
Yeah, exactly.
It was a good five years? How long have we been talking about it?
About 4 years.
Yeah.
Yep.
I finally given up on the dream.
So we can shut the window and lock it.
Don't lock that window. Do not lock that window.
It's cold out there, man.
Open it up.
You don't want that draft. I'll always
there's always a chance I'll open it back up. But here's the one, Zach, I wanted to get to because it's near and dear to your heart. Andre Drummond. Whoa. Of your Detroit Pistons.
You have tanked the hell out of the rest of the first half. It was a nice start, though, wasn't it?
You looked so right there for a couple of months. I was swearing every time they won. I was like, I know they're gonna suck. I know. And then all of a sudden, oh yeah,
every game that they were losing, Sean would screenshot it and just send it to our group chat there. And it's like, oh, how about the Pistons? Huh?
Those Pistons.
So Drummond. So you think Drummond would be available?
Drummond's been a guy that's name has floated around for years with no real, I don't think there was ever a real chance or a real discussion. But for some reason, his name keeps popping up. Mm-hmm. If the Pistons were going to deal, the Celtics would have enough to get a guy like that.
Well, I mean,
you want to see him make a move like that?
Okay.
Knowing you got to give up a lot.
See, I've come to the point where I've bought in with the Brad Stevens system and all that, and I just, for some reason, I can't see them wanting to make that deal just because he's got no value to the perimeter. Mm. So if you're getting him, you're getting him on defense, rebounding, and second chance points.
Which is not necessarily a bad thing.
I don't think that they would do that. Do I want him? Yes. If I was building a basketball team, absolutely. I'd put him right on there because I still think of basketball in the 90s. You know, I still want David Robinson and Tim Duncan.
I understand.
We all do.
We all do. You want Patrick Ewing and Charles Oakley. I get it.
Give me Hakeem.
Oh, yeah. Oh. Glory.
Hakeem and Otis Thorpe. Yep. Otis. I remember.
Rick Smits.
Rick Smits.
Vidas Sabonis.
And, yeah. Or the The Davis boys.
Ooh, Dale.
Dale and
Antonio. Antonio. Yeah, yeah. That was a squad, dude. Yeah.
And Rick Smith up front. That was a deadly front court.
That was a tough front court.
Yeah.
Tough front court. If only Reggie Miller wasn't the most overrated basketball player of all time, maybe those Pacers would have been would have won something.
Oh man. So I mean, yeah. I mean,
Andre Drummond, I say you give up the Lake. I would give up the Lakers pick for Andre Drummond.
Whoa. Okay.
Easily. That would be something that Andre Drummond's the kind of guy I would do it for. You could talk me into Marc Gasol just because then there's a lot of upside, but Andre Drummond's definitely a guy I would give that Lakers pick up for and wouldn't even think twice about.
Okay. What about the bought out / free agent market?
Well, who knows who's going to be on there?
Though? Well, I mean, there's a few players that I keep seeing.
When's the buyout?
We got plenty of time. It's usually after the deadline. Yeah. Like a week or two after the deadline.
It's March 1st.
Yeah. Yeah. That sounds about right.
Yeah.
Even if this season is all different in terms of
who knows
deadlines and whatnot, but three names that I keep seeing. Speaking of Memphis, Tariq Evans. What do you guys think about Tariq Evans coming in? He's on a 1-year deal.
Are you calling him Tariq?
What's his name? Isn't it Tariq? Tariq? Is it Tariq?
It's Tariq.
Okay, this is the way it's spelled. My bad.
Tariq.
T. Evans.
All right. Well. I would love Tariq Evans. Love Tariq Evans. I love the way he's playing this year. But you give him nothing for him.
Yeah.
I would even trade for him.
I wouldn't mind that.
You got Nikolai Mirotic out the Bulls that they're talking about, you know, cutting ties with. I love him in terms of like what he's just pure offense.
Yeah.
Off the bench.
Yeah.
And he's a good rebounder as well. Not great, but decent rebounder. I can see him in the Brad Stevens 1,000%. System.
1,000%. Yeah, I think we've talked about him before. We'd love to see him here.
And another guy that the Suns are dying to unload is Greg Monroe.
No.
Nah.
What the heck happened? What is his issue? Like, he's good around the basket. He's got a decent mid-range game. He's big. Like, why can't he just figure out basketball? I don't get it.
Why can't he just figure out basketball?
I think the game has passed him.
No, you know what it is? I think Detroit
is too slow.
He figured that, like, me and Andre Drummond were like the, like we were just mentioning, you know, the David Robinson and Tim Duncan of like the future. And the Pistons said, hold up, we're going to just go with Drummond. You go make your money elsewhere. And when he went to Milwaukee, he never fit their system because Milwaukee wanted to run and he's not that fast in terms of like the way Detroit used to play. And even the way Detroit plays now, and at this point, he's just a big contract that he should have never signed, or that the Bucks should have never signed him to. And if he's able to get a buyout from the Suns, he'd be cheap.
I don't think there's a single power forward that can play like a center anymore. I don't think you can have that in the NBA.
At all?
Not really.
I mean, Al Horford comes to mind. He's a power forward that...
Yeah, I mean, he's the... We're talking 5-6 assists a game.
Yeah,
ball runs
no,
like,
he's not.
A great pick and move with the ball.
Yeah, he's much different than... I'm talking about like an old school pass to me down in the post, let me bang. I'm going to get you 2 points every time, you know? Like that. And that's what Monroe's mentality is. It doesn't fit in the NBA anymore. Yeah, he has a certain set of skills, but it's not...
Well,
like,
that's,
look,
well, that's
look
what
at,
Zach, was that what Zach was saying about Drummond. Like, if you were to bring in Drummond, he would be...
Yeah, but Drummond's a true 7-footer.
I know, but he's just...
Body.
But he has no perimeter game whatsoever.
No, and that's a little bit of a risk, which is, I think, why, you know... So that's why I don't want Monroe, right?
I mean, look at someone like Tice, you know, an undersized power forward who could play in some center who's shooting threes now.
Exactly. But, hey, look at Marc Gasol, though. You look at Marc Gasol, he has started to develop an outside game.
Yeah, he's slowly, you know, shooting away from
you
the basket.
You have to develop that, yeah. And I think...
And that's something that Drummond and Monroe don't have.
Sure.
But I think for, you know, somebody cheap who's going to help you for the rest of the season...
Nah, he won't even get run.
Okay.
And Brad Stevens' system, when was the last guy you that was over 6'8 that didn't shoot threes?
Over 6'8?
Baines even tries to take him.
Well, Baines has a good mid-range.
Mid-range.
Yeah. Which I don't mind. I don't think you have to shoot threes. If you're
you need to be able to stretch the floor.
You can stretch the floor, but he stretches the floor pretty well without having to chuck up threes.
Causeway Street curse.
No, God. Bless you.
All right.
So,
all right.
Those,
well,
those are some some options there.
It is going to be a busy couple of days here as we are weeks away from the trade deadline. Let's put your money where your mouth is. One thing we've talked about a lot of names today. Who's the guy? Who's the guy you want the Celtics to just go out and get? Zach, number one on your list.
Number one on the list? I think Lou Williams. Lou Williams is my guy.
Lou, I am going to, I think I talked myself into it today. Marc Gasol. Marc Gasol is my guy, man. I want it to happen. Make it happen. Make it rain. Make it rain that Spanish beautiful big bodied center. Give me those dance moves down in my post.
Okay.
A little salsa.
I'm going to say another Spaniard, Nikolai Mirotic.
Okay, that's your guy.
That's my guy.
He's Spanish?
He's Spanish, yep.
Mirotic?
Yep.
He's not Spanish.
He's Spanish. Look him up.
I'm figuring this out right now.
Right, go ahead.
I am going to bet.
Go ahead.
Mirotic. That is not Zach, you're checking this?
He's checking it right now.
Yeah.
Mirotic is the most Russian name I've ever heard.
Watch.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Give it a Mirotic.
He is. Wow, that guy kind of weird. Well, here's the thing. He's Montenegrin and Spanish. Not sure how that combination works out.
Me neither.
So he is Spaniard, right? Oh, okay. He is a Spaniard.
Okay. All right. Well.
Good call. He was born in Serbia, Montenegro, Yugoslavia.
We're all right then. We're all right, okay?
He's a man of many backgrounds.
Man of many nations.
All
right. That's who we want. We want another international on the Boston Celtics, which it's worked this so far. Think of that. We'll have, where's Yabusele from?
France.
Mm-hmm.
Tice is from New Zealand.
Germany.
No, Tice is, yeah, he's German.
Baines is New Zealand.
Baines is from New Zealand, but he's Australian.
No.
Yep. He's all of Australia.
No, Baines is from New Zealand.
He's from New Zealand.
He was born in New Zealand, but then he chose to play for the Australian basketball team,
yeah,
which everybody in New Zealand hated.
Yeah. I remember when you tweeted out that he just got signed.
Yeah.
After like the whole Tommy all of Australia like comment, and someone was like, he's from New Zealand.
And I was like, what?
No, he's not.
And then I Googled it, and that's what happened. So yeah, if you're born in New Zealand, you can actually pick,
yeah,
do I want to play for New Zealand,
yeah,
or do I want to play for
Australia?
Australia. He chose Australia. Yeah. Guess who didn't choose Australia?
Kyrie.
Stephen Adams.
Oh, Stephen Adams.
Yeah. He plays for New Zealand.
That's weird. Swapping players, huh?
Yeah. Yeah.
Kyrie too had that option because he was born in Australia.
Al Horford, Dominican.
Yep.
He's got an international lineup.
We're like
Marc Gasol.
The Celtics are like the Sacramento Kings in the early 2000s. The UN over here in
the
Boston.
The UN of the NBA. All right, Zach. Thank you for bringing your expertise. Next time, we're going to have to think of a better title to introduce you as.
We'll figure it out.
Sounds good.
Real quick, before you bounce, Celtics and Warriors, who you got?
I'm gonna go Celtics.
Yeah.
I think they're gonna go out there and take care of business on this one.
All right, he is Zach Pelequin of the Causeway Street blog. Where can they find you on Twitter?
@ VAP Sports 508 or @ OTW Sports Radio.
Word. Zach, thanks again, man. It's always a pleasure. And we'll be talking to you real soon.
Yeah.
Peace out. Yeah, man. It's going to be interesting. I think this is going to be a huge trade deadline, you know, and then even afterwards when people get bought out.
I think we've said this every year, though.
Isaiah was two seasons ago, right? 2015.
Yeah. So it's been about two. The Celtics really haven't made a trade deadline move since.
No, not a big one, no.
Since Isaiah.
Actually, they haven't, yeah, at all. Yeah, you're right. Not even like a small deal. Yeah, you're right.
Every time we go into the trade deadline saying, this is it. This is it. Yeah. There we go. You know, well, we got to get Nerlens Noel over here.
Well, that season, how many trades did?
Yeah, there was like 26 trades on trade deadline day. It was ridiculous.
40 players that rotated in
everyone
and out of Boston.
Just said, you know what? We're just going to do everything that was rumored. We're just going to say yes.
Say yes.
Yes. Yes to success. So let's talk about this Warriors game really quickly.
Yeah.
The Warriors have not scored under 100 points since Christmas.
Mm.
The lowest they've scored is 108 points. They have dominated, and they haven't been undefeated.
Wait,
they lost to the Rockets.
Hold on. Didn't the Celtics hold them to under 100?
That was before Christmas.
Okay, before Christmas. Okay.
The and they won on Christmas. They scored 99 points and won.
And they went on like some 14-game road like win streak, right?
They
like
snapped by
Houston. Okay.
Houston has beat them, but still, no. So this team has been absolutely balling. 123 points, 108 points in a loss, 119 points. 118, 127, 108, 125, 124, 121, 124, 125, 141, 100, 126, and then 99. So, literally.
If you keep them under 100, it's possible to beat them. That's what you're saying?
Yeah. If you hold them, which is
what the Celtics did the first time.
Yeah, which they literally have to do, and they have to shut down Steph and Durant.
Clay. No. You just got to get Durant ejected.
Sure. And, fair.
You know.
I mean.
he has four ejections already this season.
Here's the thing. The Warriors look like they're back. They're back. Steph's back. Durant's back. Clay is just filling in that role of the fourth person. Draymond Green has been a little quiet this year. Still curious about the fact how he made an all-star team. I mean,
Shaq was giving shit to Horford. Like, oh, you know, Horford's putting up 14-6. I can do that now. Like, first of all, Shaq, you were worthless.
It's not 14-6, Shaq. It's 14-6-5, right?
Yeah, right.
When have you ever averaged more than one fucking assist in a year? Yeah, all right? Back in your prime.
But, yeah.
Moves the basketball, sets a pick and roll. Shut up, Shaq.
I'm still dumbass. Mad. I'm still mad at that dude for, like, I think he fucked up the Celtics for, like, a season or two.
The big Shamrock.
Yeah, it's fucking ridiculous.
Well, it used to be the big Cactus, and before that.
Yeah. Big Aristotle.
That was the big Aristotle. Then I went to Cleveland. That was the big Cavalier.
I was the original Superman. Dwight took my nickname.
Down in Miami, I was the big Fireball.
AKA Barbecue Chicken.
Oh, yeah.
So
now I'm the big anchor.
So he's trying to shit on Horford when Draymond is averaging 11-5 right now.
Yeah,
and made the All-Star team.
Yeah, that's a tough part. Like, I know he does a lot of dirty work.
He does it, yeah.
And like,
no one's denying that.
And I just feel like there is someone more deserving because.
Plus, it's easy to do that when you have a team like the Warriors.
You don't need four players off the team every single year to make the All-Star team.
It's easy for someone like him to look good on a team like the Warriors, right? Like, Clay puts in the work. Like
pick between Clay and Draymond.
Yeah, no one
just pick between them.
But no one talks about Clay, how he's still putting up the same amount of shots, even with Durant on the team. And he's still averaging over 20 points a game.
Okay, pick one. Paul George or Draymond Green?
Paul George.
Yes. Why is Draymond Green making the All-Star team over Paul George? It's ridiculous.
Yeah, I don't know, man.
Absolutely ridiculous. But the Celtics will continue their Western swing in Golden State and take on the Golden State Warriors. We'll be on Saturday night primetime on ABC.
It's a good little warm up before the Super Bowl.
I love Saturday night primetime.
It's good, man. It's good.
So, love it.
What do you think? W, an L, a close?
They'll win. So this is a win. Saturday night primetime, they'll win.
It'll be a tight or like easily.
No, I think.
Or will they fall like at a 20-point hole and
so
climb out of it?
No, I think Kyrie will show up. Al will show up. I think things probably need to happen. And then get what you can get out of the Tatum and Brown combo. I mean, last time, if you remember correctly, Jaylen Brown single-handedly got us back in the game against the Warriors.
He was playing some inspired basketball that night. Yep.
He was. He sure was. So if you can get that type of performance out of either Brown or Tatum, I think then the Celtics have a chance.
I think Tatum should get more shot attempts. Just throwing that out there.
Just on a hole.
Yeah. Because for someone who's shooting 48% overall and 45% from the three, who leads the NBA, by the way.
See the 3-point contest?
I don't know. That hasn't been announced yet, but.
Oh, by the way, is Jaylen Brown not in the dunk contest?
Nope. Travesty. What a shame.
I just think that's why, you know, maybe last year when you were asked, you should have just done it. You're such a good dunker, Jaylen. I'm never going to let him move that down.
He took his time to improve his game, and it's showing.
What with
it's
the
showing this year? Mm. Come on, he's definitely in the running for most improved player in the NBA, isn't he?
Would have been great if he was a dunk contest champion as well.
I say Aaron Gordon gets injured before that.
I don't watch the dunk contest.
And Jaylen Brown will be the replacement.
I'm not watching the dunk contest.
Saying it.
All right. Put it. Book it. Pick it. Stick it.
All right. This episode of the Causeway Street Podcast is brought to you by MyBookie. MyBookie is a place to score some serious cash on all your sports predictions. That's MyBookie.ag. With the Super Bowl coming, you have the luxury of not just betting on your outcome of the game, but you can make your own prop bets and make money off of in-game scenarios that happen throughout the big game. That's MyBookie.ag. I trust them, but you don't have to take my word for it. You can man up and play like the pros on game day. You can play the money line, side, or total. MyBookie is your hookup for all your betting needs and offers super fast payouts when you win. That's MyBookie.ag. Join now and MyBookie will match your deposit with up to 50% bonus. Use the promo code Causeway to activate your offer. That's promo code Causeway. Visit MyBookie.ag today. That's MyBookie.ag. You play, you win, you get paid.
Well, it's time to wrap up this episode the way we do every episode with...
In case you missed it.
In case you missed it, Marcus Smart.
Yeah.
Will miss approximately 2 weeks after cutting his right shooting hand that required stitches after apparently swiping at a picture frame at the team's hotel on Wednesday, just hours before the Celtics took on the Clippers.
Maybe it'll help. In the grand scheme of things, does he really need his shooting hand?
Well,
wouldn't the Celtics be better off if he didn't have a shooting hand?
Well, and why do you say this?
Well, he's not a great shooter.
Was that evident when he missed the...
No, I thought that was actually a good shot.
You think so?
I thought so.
Even though Rozier was wide open?
Yeah. How much time is left on the clock?
It was like 7 seconds left on the clock.
Not enough time.
Exactly. It was enough time for him to grab the rebound, run up the court, dribble, behind the back, and then shake off his defender and pop a shot. Of course not. But he did have Rozier open.
I think it was fine. If that shot went in, everyone would have said, Marcus Smart. I got in a fight with the freaking guy, friend of the show.
Who?
Green Line Tees.
I got into a fight with some dude on Twitter, too. He was, first of all, he has Marcus Smart as his, like, on his
avatar.
On his avatar. So
Marcus Smart there is was a no, hot there button
was,
topic.
There was no, you know, there was no convincing or even trying to have a decent conversation about Marcus Smart because it was like, oh, well, you know, Rozier, who was, you know, what has Rozier done? First of all, Rozier is a better shooter than Marcus Smart.
Yeah, I hate people that knock Rozier when they try to defend Smart.
Yeah.
You can just have the same, it's the same thing. But my thing is like people who just say, Marcus Smart sucks. That's what the guy was doing for Green 90s. Go out to buy the t-shirts. I love their t-shirts. But still, he was like, Marcus Smart sucks. And I don't care. No one say he's good. And then he starts throwing stats to try to prove Marcus Smart's bad. I'm like, that's ridiculous.
Well, he's not a good shooter, and he's
fine.
But the thing that bothers me the most about him is he makes a couple of threes early in the game.
Sure.
And he continues to shoot.
How many of those times do those threes go in though? When he needs to tie the game, when it's a go ahead point on a run,
it's rare. Though.
They go in. No,
he didn't shoot the whole fourth quarter besides free throws. So why was he taking that shot?
He was saving it.
Come on, man. He had like a
I didn't Rozier mind that open. Shot.
Even if Rozier missed it, I would have been like, you know what? I live with that because he tried to find the better play.
He had 22 points that night.
Yeah, I know he did.
He was feeling it.
But he didn't score other than free throws in that fourth quarter.
He was feeling it, though.
He didn't score in the fourth quarter.
That was Marcus Smart's game. But let him have the game, goddammit.
Rozier kept him in the game with a three and a layup. Well, anyways, Smart
apologized on social media as he returned to Boston on Thursday night.
Another story about a player in New England cutting their hand, and it's going to be blown way out of proportion. And it's going to be like, well, what was he doing? Was he in a fight? You'll see.
How close was he to Rex Burkhead this week?
Because it happened in the team's hotel.
So. Was Rex Burkhead there?
I don't know. Again, very little details as he was with the assistant trainer and the assistant GM at the hospital for several hours as he was getting stitches. They wouldn't even say how many stitches.
Did he wear a red glove?
Again, no details on what gloves or what type of gloves he was wearing. You know? So, I mean, I think Tom Brady's going to reach out to him and say, man, don't worry about it. It happens to the best of us. You'll be all right.
You'll be good.
You'll be good to go. You know what? Just defend. Don't shoot.
Yeah.
And you'll be all right. In case you missed it, congrats to Jaylen Brown and Jason Tatum as they were named to the Rising Stars Challenge during All-Star Weekend.
Oh, yeah. Congrats.
You can head to...
Did Jaylen Brown make it last year?
No, he didn't.
No, he didn't.
He did not.
Yeah, he didn't.
He didn't. That's probably why he was like, no, you're not going to call me to the Rising Stars Challenge? You just want me to dunk? No, I'm not going to do that. So that's the reason. Another reason why he didn't go and dunk at last year's contest. And last year's contest was bad. So
Not cool.
He'll be all right. He'll be in it this year, I think, still. I don't know how, but he will. You can head to causewaystreetblog.com for the game's full roster. You know, their format is world against Team USA. And speaking of All-Star Weekend, LeBron and Steph Curry, who were the captains for this year's format on picking teams, officially picked their squad. Kyrie will team up once again with Bron, while Al Horford, who was named as a reserve a few days ago, will be on Steph's team.
I do think it's funny how LeBron and Kyrie and Durant and Westbrook are all on the same team.
And Davis.
Cousins. And Davis and Cousins.
Yes.
It's great.
And John Wall.
And yeah. But that team's stacked. I mean, it's gonna win.
What do you think about the format? You think it's gonna make it
I think it's pretty cool. I mean, really, like, the fact that it happened behind closed doors is dumb. What I like to see, you know.
You know what it is? They don't want analysts or pretty much Twitter and social media to, like, shame the player that got picked last.
That's what's wrong with America today.
Which, I mean, you got, like, this season you have all these, like, fake fights that, you know, people just get rowdy and kind of, like, shove each other.
Who would have gotten picked last? And get in each other's
faces, but there's no fights.
Probably Al Horford would have got picked last.
Well, I don't know.
Probably.
No.
Steph would have picked Draymond at some point. So.
What about Bradley Beal? Like, what do you...
I think if you're making a team... So, I think you're probably going to pick... It'd probably be between Al Horford, my man, Oladipo.
Oh, man, Oladipo, yeah. He could be picked last because you already have a bunch of shooters and, like, guards.
But, I mean, those are the players that do well in those games. Players that don't do well in those games are players like Al Horford, are players like LaMarcus Aldridge. They just don't do well in those games because... While everyone's out there,
they want to run,
trying to go crazy and doing alley oops. They're just like, yeah, I'll pop open for a 20 footer.
Yeah,
the most exciting.
I'm open, guys.
I'm here.
Hey,
I've been open literally all game. No one's gonna pass it. All right,
I'll give it back to you if you want.
You know what? I'll just fucking rebound. That's it. All right, fine. You guys fucking do 360 alley oops all fucking day. I'll just rebound. That's cool, guys. By the way, I'm wide the fuck open at the elbow. All I need to do is pass me the ball. We got 2 points.
It's like, guys, come on. I average like 5 points in these games. Come on. Just throw me a bone. Come on. I'll throw an alley-oop to somebody. Come on. Come on, please.
Yeah, it's like Yao Ming.
Yeah, no,
Yao Ming in the All-Star game is all pretty
big,
much like...
All the big guys try to do their thing in the first half. Then the second half is like, all right, guys, we're going to run. So, yeah. Sorry.
I always love watching Yao Ming in the All-Star games. Just literally... Literally the most out of place dude. Always started, just would play 5 minutes and then be
he's
like,
"He's legit trying to post up, you know, players down low." It's like, come on, man, just put up the layup and let's go to the next play.
We're almost halfway through the 24-second shot clock. This should not be happening. Have there ever been a 24-second violation in the NBA All-Star game? The answer is no.
Probably not. You're right.
The answer is that they should make it a 15-second shot clock.
In case you missed it.
According to a report from Cleveland.com, Kyrie Irving apparently threatened the Cavaliers to sit out the season and opt to have knee surgery if his trade request was not granted. And when asked about the report, Kyrie Irving says it is not true. So, shocker on that. Though the report also states that he will at some point require a minor procedure to his broken kneecap that was repaired back in the 2015 NBA Finals. It's something to keep an eye on going forward.
In case you missed it, Gordon Hayward, we talked about how he's been all over social media shooting. And you see he has no cast on his ankle, no brace. And you know, he's not really jump shooting, but he's putting up shots and he looks pretty good. Considering
he looks damn good,
yeah. I didn't want to go that far, but you're right. He is
damn good.
He looks damn good. Prior to the Celtics tipping off against the Clippers, he was on the court for an extended period of time, putting up shots. And like Sean says, he was looking pretty damn good. He does say he wants to start traveling with the team beginning in March, so we'll see.
Yeah.
All right. In case you missed it, Jason Kidd is the latest coach to be unemployed this season in the NBA. As the report that Milwaukee was going to fire him, apparently he had no idea until Giannis Antetokounmpo called him up and asked him, what can I do to fix the situation so they don't let you go? Jason Kidd was like, what are you talking about?
It's like, Giannis, I know I've been working on the English here. I don't know if you know what you're saying.
John was like, I could talk to my agent. I could talk to the owner. Like, tell me, what can I do to fix this? Poor Jason Kidd had no idea.
No. Well,
so Jason
Kidd couldn't have happened to a better person.
Jason Kidd. You know, lasted only, what, 2.5?
Well, he sucks as a coach. He sucks as a coach.
Well, I mean, Milwaukee has been mediocre.
He sucks as a coach. That's why. Like, you have one of the best talents in the league.
Like, since
you have Chris Middleton.
Since they made it to the Eastern Conference Finals back in 2001, Game 7 against Philadelphia 76ers, they've been mediocre ever since. It's just a tough market to be in. And any player, you know, those are Ray Allen years, yes. I hope Giannis Antetokounmpo, who wears number 34, so that won't get retired anytime soon in Milwaukee. I hope he remains a Milwaukee Buck for a long period of time, but they have a hard time holding on to players like that, franchise guys. So good luck to Milwaukee, because right now they're hovering as a 500 team.
I thought that was a team that could contend.
Well, I mean, they could still make the playoffs considering the other teams in the Eastern Conference, so they shouldn't be too worried about that. In case you missed it, could the Cavaliers be looking to trade Isaiah Thomas?
Oh, back to the Celtics? What?
rumor has it that the Cavs are eyeing players, well, in particular guards, such as Kemba Walker and George Hill as potential players.
Yeah, I mean, you're going to trade Isaiah Thomas for Kemba Walker? They're the exact same player. Mm. You're going to trade...
Except Kemba Walker's over 6 feet tall.
Barely. Hmm. Barely. If that. I don't know. I think Isaiah Thomas is a better player than Kemba Walker. But I will say this. I know it's a little early to tell, but I fucking told you so. But I told you the Cavs aren't going to be that good this year.
Listen, this is the same. This is around the same time of every season since LeBron has been back in Cleveland that the Cavaliers pull off a trade and everyone goes, how the hell did they do that?
Yeah, yeah. I doubt they're going to. I mean, what if
talking about DeAndre Jordan also. I've heard, obviously, you'll continue to hear DeMarcus Cousins'
if
name.
If I'm New Orleans, I would probably trade DeMarcus Cousins for Isaiah Thomas.
Okay.
Because
I don't know how that helps New Orleans.
No, it would, because then you could have a core of Anthony Davis and Isaiah Thomas. Okay. You're guarding your big. Then you can build. You can re-sign Isaiah, give the Cavs DeMarcus Cousins, let him be their problem.
So you just don't think this Cousins and Davis project is going
to
work?
I don't see how it's going to work.
I think they need more players surrounding
them. See, but I just think that you having the Twin Towers is such a outdated mentality.
They're both killing it, though.
Right, they're both killing it. And
over
20
points, over 10 rebounds.
And they're hovering around 500.
And over 5 assists between both of them.
Sure, sure, but you need a guard. Rajon Rondo is coming in and being like the savior of that team right now. I mean, Jrue Holiday isn't a bad player. He played well against Celtics, but he's totally inconsistent.
But then that's it. I mean, Etuan Moore.
But if you could just flop Isaiah Thomas for DeMarcus Cousins and maybe see how they're gonna be
players at the trade deadline. Yeah. I don't know what or who they're gonna acquire.
Just hope they don't get Lou Williams.
But the way things go in the NBA, that might be the case.
That probably happens.
Because they do need a shooter.
Yeah, they sure do.
If they want to contend in the West in terms of not just being a playoff team, but again making some noise, because people's jobs on the line in New Orleans.
They could probably trade Isaiah Thomas for Lou Williams, make about the same amount of money.
That'd be messed up, though.
It would be.
That would be messed up.
That technically means you traded Kyrie Irving for Lou Williams.
Yeah,
and Jay Crowder.
Yeah,
Jay Crowder's probably gone too.
You think so?
Yeah, he's just not fitting in there.
Hmm. I don't know. It's tough.
Come back to the Celtics, Jay. Isaiah. We'll take him.
Just wave him.
Wave him. Oh. Imagine that bombshell. Danny Ainge wins again.
Isaiah Thomas is like the double agent right now. He's like, I got you, Danny. I'm going to tear this team apart from the inside.
I'm going to go. Once I'm ready to play, I'm going to start pointing so many goddamn fingers.
I will divide this locker room so much.
Little do they know that Isaiah Thomas actually put a lot of laxatives in Kevin Love's Gatorade. Then called him out for being a zip, and then had to prove he had diarrhea.
Oh what? You're just gonna play 2 minutes, and they're just gonna be like, you know what, guys? I'm gonna sit this one out.
I ain't feeling too good.
I'm not feeling good. And he made the All Star team.
You zip.
Go figure.
You play 2 minutes and you go home.
Well, this, in case you missed it, is brought to you by.
You ever heard of Pepto Bismol?
The CLNS mobile app. Make sure you download the best in audio and video sports coverage online. You can also listen to the Causeway Street podcast on there, and make sure you subscribe to the CLNS YouTube channel. where you can also listen and watch the Causeway Street podcast.
Bada bing, bada boom.
Realest guy in the room.
What?
I just wanted to rhyme.
Okay.
That's all right, Scal. Just wanted to rhyme real quick, you know? And that is it for...
In case you missed it.
And yeah, so, Sway, get well. And
come back soon, Sway.
Yeah, that's it. Make sure you peep us on the social media outlets, all at Causeway Street.
Yes, do that. And until next time, everybody.
We'll see you soon, guys.
Bye.
Peace out.
Before we see